should have been afternoon, but it's actually still morning because we are running a little ahead. So I'm going to go through my piece now, and hopefully that will give us a little bit more time for interaction and discussion at the panel event later in the day. So I suppose my presentation is very much around the work, the mentoring and quality development service that has been developed as part of the brief of Better Start. So it's kind of very much bringing us back home to the present and to services in Ireland. And it, I suppose having heard the speakers this morning, Professor Mellish and Julius, we are, I suppose, reassured and affirmed that we're on the right track and that what we're developing is actually very positive and very helpful in terms of ensuring the quality of our children's experience in early childhood services. So I'm going to tell you, some of you in the room I know are very familiar with Better Start already, but I'm going to bring you through a little bit about our model and how it works and what we see as the progress that we've made to date. So Better Start was developed as an initiative by the Department of Children and Youth Affairs in order to enhance the quality of children's experience in early years education settings. It's a collaborative project between the Department of Children and Youth Affairs, as I said, the Department of Education and Skills, and PUBL to establish a cohesive approach to quality across early years. I noted from Julius's last slide about having said the right time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. I'll get to that in a little while, but in effect, in 20 years ago, we did plant a tree, but maybe we haven't actually nurtured and fed it as much as we might have done, and that's part of, I suppose, where we're now compensating for those for that time. So the programme is managed by DCYA and hosted by PUBL, who acts as the employers for the team that have been employed to roll out the quality development service. The primary focus of the initiative is to provide quality early years mentoring support to ECC settings. And I'm particularly delighted to welcome some of our colleagues in those settings who've come to join us today. The broader aim is to bring coordination and cohesion, as was mentioned earlier, and consistency to the provision of quality supports. There is, as Dr. Riley said, an investment of about 13 million going into quality supports, but it's in quite dispersed and not necessarily coordinated and strategically leveraged ways, and that's something that we will be working with our colleagues in CCCs and BCOs to improve over the coming months. So the wider brief of Better Start is to bring together, as I said, the efforts under the various CCCs and voluntary organisation structures and our own quality development service to improve and deliver kind of quality supports that are appropriate and, I suppose, culturally acceptable and practical within the remit and within the constraints that operate in early childhood settings, about which we are very aware and very sensitive. As I mentioned, 20 years since we planted the tree. 20 years ago, we first, in terms of monitoring and quality, we first introduced regulation of early childhood in Ireland and then went through a period of development and growth, capital development, again with funding from the EU, largely supported the development of infrastructure. Within that period of time, we also developed our quality frameworks, the SHIELTA quality framework and ASHTA, our curriculum framework, and developed a workforce development plan and invested in the development of staff and people working in services through a variety of succession of learner funds and other initiatives, the development of targeted training for people working in early year settings. And, you know, as the free preschool year was introduced in 2010, and with it came the quality agendas followed on from that, and in terms of, because as all of the research and all of the information that we've heard this morning validates, is that children benefit, derive huge benefit, lifelong lasting benefit from participation in early childhood settings, as long as those settings are of high quality. and the higher quality, the more benefit that children derive. And therefore, the quality agenda is in parallel with the future development and expansion of services is a key component. So what do we want for our children? We have a policy framework, Better Outcomes, Brighter Futures, which sets out the kind of key goals that we want for our children, that they would be active and healthy, that they would be achieving in all areas of learning, that they would be safe and protected from harm, that they would have economic security and opportunity, which I suppose in the last presentation we saw the importance of that, and that they would be connected and respected and contributing. And again, Professor Mellish's presentation about interaction and the importance of connection emphasised that point for us also. So, as I said, there are a number of key players who really need to work together in a more targeted and more streamlined and more coordinated way in order to ensure that quality support is maximised to the sector in Ireland. So just to tell you a little bit about our implementation to date, we have 30 mentors working right across the country, office based in four locations, but actually working across all of the counties where there are services. We particularly focused in the development of our work on full daycare services, so they're the services that we're primarily working with. And I just did a brief calculation, I suppose, in terms of looking at the multiplier effect. So of those, at the moment, there's 30 mentors working with 271 services, a couple more added this week, but actively engaged with 271. And across those services, there's over 3,800 staff working and catering for 22,400 children. So the reach of a quality initiative working collaboratively in those settings with those staff can benefit that number of children in quite a short period of time. So I suppose that's really one of the benefits, the multiplier effect of working in this way and the development of this model. So our approach, as I said, we targeted in the first year of our operation, operation from about February, March of this year. So we targeted services that were full daycare, particularly services that cater for children under three. And again, everything that we've heard this morning, I suppose, emphasises that that was a good decision because there's been a dearth of attention paid, both in terms of training, in terms of resources, and in terms of funding to those children. And so I suppose that was one of our kind of priorities areas, was because the children who are under three, who are in full daycare services, spend a significant proportion of their life in those services, and therefore the quality of those services is very important. So that's, you know, where we started from. So we've been working with full daycare providers, and we'll continue to do that for a period of time, and obviously then we'll extend our reach to sessional services throughout the country. Our philosophy is very much that children are at the centre, and all of our efforts, I suppose, are targeted towards ensuring that those children have the best experience possible. ECC providers and parents being the kind of primary carers for children, particularly when they are in full daycare, and they're supported by CCCs, by the education structure, by voluntary organisations, and all of that underpinned by state policy and provision, which, as we're aware, the focus and emphasis on early years has grown substantially in recent years. We operate a mentoring model, and the purpose of a mentoring model is the translation of training and knowledge into practice, including self-evaluation of quality. Most of a huge number of services, thanks to learner funds and thanks to people's own commitment and dedication, have undertaken training in the last 5 years at level 5, at level 6, at level 7, and we have an increasing population of higher level graduates coming out of our institutions. But the translation of that knowledge into practice has been identified as problematic, and therefore mentoring is seen as a way to support that level of professional development. So the development of practices and values to implement quality standards, particularly the standards that are outlined in our Shield the Framework, which covers children from birth to six, and supporting the establishment of environments, interactions, which we heard this morning are key, and practices that support children's learning and development as confident and competent learners, as is outlined in our ASHTER curriculum framework. So to support our work, as those of you who have been working with us would be very much aware, we very much use a new resource that has been developed in order to bring together and make practically applicable the ASHTER and SHIELTA frameworks. So it's a resource, the ASHTER and SHIELTA Practice Guide, which has been developed by colleagues in the NCCA and is available as an online resource to all services. And it is particularly, it's our manual, it's our Bible, I suppose, for our mentors working in services. And we have found it to be a really practical and really useful and really relevant resource. So just to give you a little brief overview for those who may not be familiar with Practice Guide, it is devised around, I suppose, first of all, the introduction to curriculum. What is curriculum about? What does it mean? How do we establish curriculum as the foundation for children's early learning? And then it looks at six pillars, or contains six pillars that contribute to the development of curriculum. So building partnership with parents, obviously key, children's primary educators and primary supporters, and we heard earlier the importance of the home learning environment and the persistence of that throughout life. Creating and using the learning environment, so ensuring that our settings actually provide children with the opportunities for them to explore and to follow their interests and to develop the skills and dispositions and learning opportunities that early childhood can provide. Learning through play, certainly valuing play, valuing children's initiative, children's own curiosity, enthusiasm and exuberance, I think as the word was used in the Starting Strong report, which I happen to like a lot. Nurturing and extending interactions, again, the fundamental keystone, I suppose, of children's learning is the interactions with those, both with their peers and with those that care for them. Planning and assessing, using themes and using developmentally appropriate interventions that support and scaffold children's learning, and supporting transitions, both the transition from home into early childhood settings and potentially into school, but also the daily moment-to-moment transitions that children experience in the settings from day to day. So the SHIELTA, ASHTER and SHIELTA Practice Guide talks about emergent and inquiry-based curricula, using children's and practitioners' interests and questions and experience as starting points for curriculum planning, and how those kind of curriculums are built in order to support children's learning. Through getting to know children well, it's fundamental, and again feeds into interactions, using children's individual knowledge, abilities and needs as guides in terms of how we respond to them. Knowing how to support and extend learning, the example we were giving this morning, sustained shared thinking being a primary feature of how that works best. Reviewing the impact of the curriculum, seeing is it working, is it suiting all of these children, is it suiting this particular child, is it working in this setting. Using ASHTER's learning goals and sharing the vision of the curriculum with parents and with others who are involved in the care and well-being of children. So what we want to see and what we are looking to develop and what we believe, I suppose, is our vision of the child is as a confident and competent learner, a confident and competent explorer. And I suppose these are the developments that we're looking to support and ensure that children have. Try to catch up with myself here. So how do we support services? Well, as I said, using the self-evaluation tools in particular, the practice guide has a range of resources and materials that are used within settings by practitioners and by our mentors to support practice. Self-evaluation tools are key to that. We talked this morning, we heard about the value of monitoring and self-evaluation as a key component of quality. And self-evaluation tools that are contained in the practice guide are essential elements of that. And we provide feedback through observation, sometimes through doing joint assessments, using the practice guide, using the evaluation tools, or using video to monitor and provide feedback so people actually see in, we're very sometimes unaware of our own interactions and our own impact, but when we see it fed back to us and observe how we are ourselves in settings, painful and all though that can be at times, it's a really powerful and really useful tool, and that's something that we're trying to develop the use of in our practice. Then we move to discuss and identify and agree quality development goals. So what are the key things that a service themselves wish to develop? Where do they see the opportunities within their own service to improve quality? And what resources do they have available to bring to bear to ensure the quality is improved? Then those goals and actions are documented, as we know the importance of documentation in terms of tracking and ensuring things actually happen. And then we work through the goals on subsequent visits over a period of time. So the goals are linked to pillars of practice, the pillars of practice I mentioned in relation to the practice guide, and they're very specific and very clear and very much tailored to the individual setting and the individual service and the children within the room that we're working with at any one given time. They're attainable within a reasonable framework. They have a number of associated actions, and additional goals can be identified as the work progresses because they evolve and emerge. Our mentoring is as much emergent as the curriculum that we hope to foster. So, probably can't read that too well, but that would be just an example of one goal. So, for instance, in a baby room, is to create and use the learning environment and extend the opportunities to children within that environment. So you see there's a specific goal which outlines the actions and the reason why those actions are important, and then sets out a number of steps that will be taken in order to reach that goal and achieve the aim of enhancing the child's learning experience. So just to show you a couple of examples of work that we've been, I suppose, privileged to be involved with and have had the permission of services to share some of their experiences. So in one instance, there was a service, one of our mentors was working with in the west of Ireland, where traditionally this week there would have been a beautiful painted plate that went home to be stuck on the fridge. And that was a kind of standard activity that a lot of children undertook. But this year, as a result of some discussion about inquiry and about following children's interests, what was actually brought into the setting was a pumpkin. And children were then given exposure to the pumpkin, if you like, and allowed to explore it and think about it and talk about it. And this child then painted their own representation of a pumpkin who's running. So a creative expansion of the potential of a pumpkin. And again, such a simple change, and yet such a significant change potentially for that child. Again, an example of educators noticing and following children's interests. A child, probably as a result of a story, maybe in the centre or maybe at home, painted a beanstalk at free playtime. And this was observed by the educators in the setting. And she then drew a giant, as you do when you have a beanstalk, you need a giant somewhere at the top of it. And this then prompted the staff to plan experiences around Jack and the Beanstalk and extend that learning and that thinking and follow the child's idea. And I mean, how affirming is that for a child? That something that they produced then gives rise to a whole activity and maybe a whole series of events involving their peers and the adults that they work with and have such an important relationship with. Another service decided that they were going to revisit their mission statement and seek the contribution of parents and children to review their mission statement and ensure that it encompassed all the views of the people, the most important people in the service, the children and the parents. So they asked, what do you want for your child during their time here, and what do you want for yourself as we work in partnership? A very powerful message to parents. Baby room introduced treasure baskets. We love treasure baskets in Better Start. So natural materials for children to explore and very easily put together. It's just a kind of an assembly of things that people have very much in place. And again, just another opportunity for children to explore materials. As we know, children are just as interested in the spatula and the saucepan as they are in the Fisher-Price kitchen. So just to make those materials accessible and available to children is, again, a simple change that can be brought about very easily. And in this particular setting, there was a space, I suppose, that was unused. It was kind of, you know, it was used to dump things that maybe weren't working anymore until they were cleared out. And it has now been transformed into a usable space for children. So it now has a mud kitchen and a water wall and various, as you can see, it's just been made a space that now children can use and gain benefit from. And that's outdoors, which in Ireland is pretty good. So we also, I suppose, in terms of just our own practice and our own process, have sought feedback from the services that we'd worked with. So during the summer, the first 145 services that we had worked with, we surveyed to ask them, how are we doing? Is it working well for you? Is this helpful? And we sent out SurveyMonkey online, and we got, 63% response rate? I think we got quite a good response rate, so we were pleased with that. So we asked a whole range of questions. Most of them were just three tick box, but we also asked a couple of qualitative questions so that we could actually get people's individual views and comments back. So feedback from services, this is just a response from one set of questions, was that people would like more time and longer hours in terms of face-to-face support and contact. So obviously the role that the mentor was playing in the service was found to be valuable, and people would like more of that. So we've reviewed individually with services on an individual basis to see where we can facilitate that. Access for funding for quality development and resources. That doesn't come as a surprise to anybody, and obviously that's going to be a key feature ongoing in kind of growing the development in early childhood in Ireland. Acknowledgement of service users' needs and constraints, again, that was related to funding, very often related to time, the need for people to have non-contact time in order to spend time even with the mentor, in order to reflect themselves, in order to plan as a team and work together as colleagues. So that notion of non-contact and planning time is really important. And then the extension of support beyond an initial six-month period. In some cases, that may be something that we will do, that we will extend the support in terms of the mentor staying on. In some cases, it will be through working collaboratively with our colleagues in CCCs and VCOs around what additional support can be provided. We were very pleased with this one. Recommendation, would you recommend Better Start Quality Development Service to colleagues or contacts within the early years sector? And we got a resounding 95% yes to that. So we feel that was very positive. And coming from our peers in the sector, we took great pride in that, actually, and great satisfaction that the job that we're doing is being useful to people and is appreciated. And that was certainly a huge boost to our mentors who are working in the field. So in terms of our ambition, where do we want to go to from here? Well, I suppose from our perspective, and we see this as a long-term project, building quality and capacity to reach critical mass with the implementation of the Shielta and Estra frameworks as the norm, that they actually are the norm, that they become the day-to-day currency of early childhood practice in Ireland. And that's very much where we're aiming to get to, and what the Asher and Shield Practice Guide is about, and all of the quality supports that we will coordinate and leverage over the coming years. Validating consistent standards and qualities through audit and inspection, so verifying for people that they have reached the standards, because sometimes it does take an external validation to actually provide the evidence. So whether it's a Shield to QAP validation, whether it's a quality audit that rates people at a certain level of quality, whether it's a fully compliant inspection or with the introduction of the education-focused inspections, which will actually provide a rating in terms of the quality of the service, which I think would be extremely valuable to services. Continuing professionalisation of the workforce, seeing ECs as a valuable career option, a viable career option for highly qualified and committed professionals. And again, that is reliant on enduring and increasing and growing the investment, the government and state investment, that has been increased, obviously, in this year's budget, but still has, as was acknowledged by our minister this morning, still has a way to go. But there is a commitment, I think, to following that path and increasing that investment. And I suppose finally and most importantly, inclusive and high quality services for all children, regardless of ability or social or cultural background. And not alone in the services that we currently have and the children attending them, but in those small minority of children that we heard about who currently aren't accessing the services or can't participate in them as fully, whether it's due to disability or some other social, economic or cultural disadvantage in terms of language or being a minority group. Certainly with the announcement in the budget of funding for additional support for children with disabilities to access, that's a huge step forward in terms of that particular piece of work and one that we welcome absolutely. So I suppose for us, where we see where we're going and what we would like to achieve in Ireland is sustained investment that actually builds and supports the infrastructure of early childhood education, standards and regulation and data so that we know that we're doing well and we know how well we're doing and where we need to improve, professional and career development, ongoing professional development, and quality services for all children who attend early childhood settings in Ireland. So thank you for your attention.